God of Jacob, great I am, King of angels, Son of man, voice of many waters, song of heaven's throne, louder than the thunder, make your glory known.
Worship the Lord tonight. All right, let me hear a countdown from 10. Ready? 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2.
Glory. There's a fire in our belly. come out. All right. Now step out of your boundaries and give someone a hug. Now I want you all to sit down. Sit down, everybody. Oh, my word. This is a rowdy crowd tonight. Hey, why are all those seats empty right there? Cool. Let's just keep inviting people. Man, I feel rowdy tonight. That song just like lit this whole place up. Hey, Bob. Hey, do Bob and I look darker? We were in Arizona for 3 days under the Arizona sun. I know you said, who is that Hispanic guy up there, right? Right? Okay, I better get at it. Tonight we are going to receive communion together. And again, this is the most intimate thing we do as Christians. Above all the rules and the regs and everything people will tell you, it's really about Jesus. And the way the Father structured this from creation until the end, it's about His Son. His Son who sits at His right hand right now. The one who cheers you on. The one who loves you passionately. And it was Him who was on earth as a human and showed us, even above church leaders, how to live. How to live our lives in such a way that we show love to one another when it would be so easy to show hate. When we give someone a break when they're caught dead to rights. When we show mercy and we show grace, that was Him. So He was with His apostles that night, and everything Jesus did, He showed love, and He reached way back to the Exodus in this one. It was like during the Passover, and they always had bread. And they always had wine, and we have juice is what we have. And what He did is He stood up in front of them, and bread is the staff of life. Jesus was from Bethlehem, which is house of bread. And He told His disciples, I am the bread of life. If you're going to have life, you better come to the bread. And Jesus said, I'm the bread that gives everybody life. And He held this up and He broke it. And He said, this is my body, which is broken for you. In fact, I'm going to get hurt so bad that they won't recognize me. And I'm doing that so that I can heal you. You get that? I'm going to be wounded, and you're the one that's going to get healed. Is there anything fair about that? And that's what love does. That's what our God does. And that's why you come here. That's why we learn lessons. That's why we eat dinner. That's why we give high fives here. We want that same love to capture us in where we're at. Right in the middle of our messy lives. And we want it to offer bread, life, to us. Jesus says, this is my body which is about to be split and broken for you. He said, this is the bread of life. Take and eat it all, He said. And every time you do this in remembrance of me. And then He took a cup and He held it up. Probably bigger than this one. I couldn't find the other one. I don't know where it is, but this will do. Representation of what Jesus held up. And He said, listen to me, guys. I'm about to go away, but they're about to put me in the press. Just like they put grapes in a press and squeeze all the juice out, how it dies. And then the fragrance comes out of that and life comes out of that. This is my blood, He said, which is shed for you. For you. Put your name in there. This is my blood, which is shed for you. My goodness, He didn't leave any of us out. So with that, the table is ready. It's for anyone who loves Jesus, who wants Jesus to be a part of their life, who isn't ashamed of Him. You might have sin in your life, which most of us do, And so before we do this, let's just say the Lord's Prayer together and ask the Lord to forgive our sins again. So our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever and ever. Take a second in your heart of hearts and just go to the Lord and ask the Lord, is everything right inside of me? And if it isn't, ask him to remove the sin, and he will do that and prepare you for love to capture your heart. And when you're ready, I'm going to be standing right up here. And what you do is come right up here. I'll give you a piece of bread and you eat it. And then you go over here, and I got Mitch, who's going to be on this side, and Christian's going to be on that side. And they're going to serve you this. It'll be non-alcoholic. I just want you all to know that, okay? So when you're ready, you come. The table is ready.
Worthy.
Revelation 5 says, "Then I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll. And I wept because no one was found who was worthy to open the scroll. Then one of the elders said to me, 'Do not weep. See that the Lion of Zion.
Pride of Zion, prophet spoke, our Messiah, flesh and bone. You alone are worthy to open up the scroll. Like a lamb you suffered. Oh, hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Help us to remember that it's you at the center of everything that we do. It's in your holy name that we bless these words and this music and everything Pastor Randy's about to preach tonight. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You can be seated. Up until this point, we have been talking primarily about stories from the first half of the Bible, what we call the Old Testament. Tonight we move into the New Testament, the second half. If you look at your Bibles, it's the much smaller part of it, but really it's the second half. It is the point where the story turns, where just when things look their darkest, God moves. But God moves quietly. You might even say covertly. Behind the scenes. But the movement is important nonetheless. Turn to your neighbor right now and shake hands with them, but shake hands with them with the hand that is not your dominant hand, and tell them, I know how you feel. I know how you feel. Just say that one more time again with me. I know how you feel. So many times when I'm in premarital counseling with young couples, we will come across what is inevitably a major flaw in men. And it exists primarily because men are just trying to do the right thing. Ladies, give me a big strong amen if you agree with this statement. Women are way more sophisticated than men. You hear that, men? Men, give me a giant grunt if you simply agree with that. Women are the latest generation iPhone. They can communicate in any number of ways. They can call, they can text, they can Insta, they can do all kinds of things. Heck, they can even read body language. Or so you think. Men, we are like those old school rotary phones that you actually had to spin the dial on that made sparks on the inside of it. We're a one-way communication device. But what's interesting is sometimes when I get into these counseling situations, and most husbands over time they learn this, but it always bears relearning because us husbands don't always do so good at this. The woman will say, I had a tough day. And the man will try and fix it. He will say, well, why don't you do this? Or why don't you do that? Or why don't you try this? Or why don't you try that? Because in his heart, he just wants his girl, his wife, his girlfriend, he just wants her to be happy. And to him and his little compartmentalized mind, that's how you do it. You fix it. So fix it. Why don't you do this? But ladies, how does that come off to you? You're annoyed by it. What the ladies just want to hear first, men and young men, hear me out. Because if you really listen and take this to heart, I am saving you a whole world of hurt.
Men, young men, not old men, you're a lost cause. Or young men. Young men, repeat after me. Ready? I know how you feel. Oh, I got a better one. Men, repeat after me. Yeah, that sucks. Say it. See the women back there? They're like, yes! That's all I want to hear! It's true. It's true. It's true. I will say this, ladies. Be patient with us men, because not only do we have to learn that, but we have to relearn that. The story of Jesus, the one who has so many names, God the Son, the powerful Word present at creation, and God said, let there be light. And it was the Word. Jesus was the living Word. The Lion of Judah. The Lamb of God. God with skin on. Come to say to us, I know how you feel. And it comes very covertly, very quietly. So I want to move to this. I want to tell you a story about two Steves, a Larry, and a Walter. Two Steves, a Larry, and a Walter. And each of these people found themselves in a cave. In a cave hidden away from the rest of the world. In a cave where they were wondering if they were crazy. In a cave where they were wondering if anything they were doing was actually going to make any sense. In a cave where they wondered if anything they were working on was actually going to make any difference in the world. In a cave where the rest of the world had no idea who they were, why they were there, didn't care. They might as well not even existed to the rest of the world. Because the rest of the world was focusing on any number of really stupid stuff. But two Steves, Larry and a Walter, were in their caves. And I'm here to tell you tonight, great things, world-changing things, start hidden away in caves that nobody sees or hears about or knows about. Until it's revealed in such a way that it is undeniable. So, who are the two Steves, Larry and Walter? Well, the two Steves, in their cave, a garage, because a garage is like a cave, in their garage, these two Steves started a company in 1976. Hidden away, nobody knew them, nobody cared, nobody thought they would amount to anything. A couple college dropouts, actually. Steve Wozniak and Steve Jobs, who in 1976 founded a company named Apple in a cave, in their garage. And they just thought to themselves, what if we invented a computer that people could actually have in their homes? Raise your hand if you have an Apple product right now. Raise your hand if you've ever had an Apple product. One of the biggest companies in the world, and not just big, one of the companies that has changed the world in ways that they could have never anticipated. And while the rest of the world was worrying about what was the latest celebrity doing and movie star doing and all that stupid stuff, they were changing the world, starting in a cave. Larry, same story. His name was Larry Page. He had a friend named Sergey. Larry Page and Sergey Brin in their cave started in 1997, a company you might recognize called Google. Laughed at. In fact, some of the bigger companies at the time, Yahoo and others, tried. They actually offered, do you want to buy Google out? And they laughed at them because they didn't think it would amount to anything. Oh my gosh, how wrong can you be? Two guys in a cave. And nobody believed in them. Most people didn't even know they existed. I am here to warn you today. Pay attention to those things hidden and tucked away, because they changed the world. Walter loved to draw. He sent some of his drawings to various newspapers. Maybe I could be a comic book artist or something, you know, be in the papers. And everybody told him, your drawings are terrible. They lack imagination. So Walter said, okay, I'm just going to hole up in my cave, his garage again. And since nobody wants to buy my drawings or anything, I'm just going to start my own company. The year was 1923, and Walter was Walter Walt Disney. Has anybody ever seen a Disney movie? Yeah. Raise your hand if you've ever been to Disneyland or Disney World and paid way too much. Big things start in caves. And the biggest one of all started a little over 2,000 years ago, hidden and tucked away in a cave. Tucked away in a cave. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. So think about this. The Roman Empire, the most powerful person in the known world at that time, the emperor, Caesar Augustus. You'll find him in all kinds of textbooks, history books, right? Caesar Augustus. The focal point of everybody's attention. All the papers were writing about him. What's Caesar wearing today? Who's Caesar dating today? Blah, 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 blah. He issues a decree. I want a census because I want to make sure we're collecting enough taxes. I want to make sure that nobody's cheating us. And so if I know how many people are everywhere, I know how much I should be collecting. This is all about money. Everybody was paying attention to everything except Joseph and Mary. And he went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born that was coming too fast. It was unexpected. And Joseph didn't have time to find somewhere for them to stay. And it says she gave birth to a firstborn, a son, and she wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger. Read the last line with me. Because there was no guest room available for them. And so they literally ended up in a cave. The Son of God, the Lion of Judah, the Messiah that all the Jews had been waiting for, hidden away, quietly born in a cave. What do you think the headlines in all the newspapers at the time were talking about at that time, that day? Everything but the one thing that would change the world the most. Everything but the one person that the very empire that ordered this a mere 200 years later would bend the knee and worship this same baby. Compared to Jesus, Disney, Google, Apple are child's play in terms of impact. Think about that. Big things. Big things come from caves. Not only do they come from caves, but the truth of the matter is, we all in our lifetimes at times find ourselves in caves, don't we? You ever felt like you were in a cave? You ever felt depressed, full of anxiety, scared? You ever felt like you weren't measuring up? Ever felt like you couldn't keep up? Give me an amen if you've ever felt that one. You felt like you were in a cave. And you wondered if you'd ever get out. You wonder if you'd ever see daylight again. It can be pretty suffocating, can't it? I've been there. I know how you feel. Yeah, it sucks. It sucks. And I'm here to tell you that the one person that can help you out of your cave was the one that was born in a cave. I want to show you a testimony. He's a rapper. His name is Propaganda. Listen to his story. You talk about being in a cave and being raised in a tough cave-like neighborhood. Listen to his story and how the one who was born in a cave helped him out of his.
My story begins kind of like it's a fish out of water story. Even though I was born in South Central LA, my particular story starts 20 minutes outside of that in the San Gabriel Valley in West Covina, La Puente area. So I grew up in like an all Mexican, like super violent neighborhood. I didn't even know it was as dangerous as it was. I just thought that that's just that's how people live. My neighbor's house became a crack house. Like I didn't know that. I just knew they didn't turn on the electricity. And I thought it was like camping, like they're, you know, they cook with candles, but no crack. I was the one black kid being teased because of my color, getting chased home, getting banged on when we walking home, like, where you from, me? I'm like, and I recognize homie, like, I'm like, Paco, man, like, I live two streets from you. What are you talking about? And then even when we moved out to the suburbs, even there, again, like, that was a predominantly Caucasian neighborhood, and we were the poor kids that just moved in, and just these weird black people that spoke Spanish. You know what I'm saying? And like, they just couldn't, they didn't get us. And even down the street at the church we went to, for some reason for me, I was getting convicted. Like, I feel like God has split the roof open and is talking to me directly. But the guys that were my age, I remember them not being affected at all. But it just tripped me out because like, I felt like nobody else felt like that. But in my mind, it went back to just same way I grew up. Well, I've been the only my whole life. So if I'm gonna be the only here, I'll be the only there. Meanwhile, church service I was never missing. Mama made me take notes to see if I was listening. But I lived among the Mexicans, so I never did the Crip thing. Instead, they gave me cans to write my name up on the bricks thing. All the while, God was training me to hear his voice. Cause only he knew that I would soon make a choice. I was this tagger, slash rapper, son of a Black Panther. And they got high hopes for him. He gonna be a pastor. So should he run with the church boys, the backpackers of thugs? And it's funny, it seemed like the Lord's answer was all of the above. I like to say that I was slow cooked in that I would say it started in sixth grade and then culminated my junior year. Examining just my experience in life and just always again feeling like I don't belong. whether I was born the wrong color, in the wrong neighborhood, in the wrong decade, to the wrong parents, like all this, like I'm just not an alpha male who's an artist. Like I would draw all the time. I wrote poetry, come on now, you know what I'm saying? So I think there was a moment when my father finally pointed to a particular passage, Psalms 139, before you were in the womb, I knew you. He said, you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows well. And I think that it was there that I realized that my value is not determined by some particular innate quality that I have. No, your value is because God was willing to pay the cost of his son for you. That's the price he was willing to pay for you. But it cost me personally nothing. That all this was on purpose. Everything you are, your whole goulash of experiences and gifts, all the scars, every hurt, every failure, being spit on walking home, like all this, it's on purpose. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. You're exactly what I want you to be. You was looking at a last born, rightful heir to the throne, son of a nobody with poverty in my bones, and that's beautiful. See, we ain't never had nothing, but nothing was sufficient. It kept my belly full of the stuff the rich was missing, and that's beautiful. My mama used to say, don't nothing God do go to waste, and I'm seeing that happen in my life. When I started rapping full time, doing poetry full time, being so comfortable, you know, among Mexicans, being able to identify with their struggle. I know what it means, like I get it, you know what I'm saying? Like, I speak the language, I know the slang, I know the pitfalls, like, I know all that. I feel like my run has been a proclamation of that truth, that like, my block didn't make me, the creator did. So in honor of Jimi Hendrix, I string my life instrument backwards and choose to play the back, cause in the word last is first, and that's beautiful. Like the pain and every scar you got, I prefer to call them life tattoos. They're masterpieces, they're beautiful. In the most intimate and personal way to say this, Christ has, he's given me personhood. My name is Jason Petty, aka Propaganda. Now I am second.
Years ago, when the world was looking everywhere else, God came to earth. To change everything. To reclaim it for himself. To steal your heart. To change your life. And he was born in a cave so that he might look at you and say, I know how you feel. I know. And he took broken flesh upon himself so that he could look at you and say, I know how you feel. He felt fatigue so that he could look at you and say, I know how you feel. He felt betrayal so that he could look at you and say, I know how you feel. He felt pain so that he could look at you and say, I know how you feel. And he would die so that he could look at you and say, I've paid your price. I know how you feel, and I love you. Let me assure you, the one who was born in a cave can lift you out of yours. And he will if you turn to him. Because who could you trust more to lift you out of your cave other than the one who rose from the dead out of a cave. And if Jesus rose from the dead, and I believe he did something nobody else has ever done, which means that whatever he has to say, I'm going to listen to. I'm going to trust. I'm going to believe. And I'm going to follow. And I have found in my life that the more I do that, the less time I spend in my cave, and the more I celebrate the mystery and the awesomeness of a God who chose to come in one and rise from one. He's the one that changed the world. Amen? Yeah. Let's pray. You guys are awesome. Father, we are so easily distracted from all of the truly important things that are going on around us and being born around us and hiding in caves around us that in some future point are going to change the world. But most of all, Lord, we recognize tonight that you chose to come covertly with humility, and you were born in a cave, and that you lived a life that can relate to us and our struggles and our dark periods. But because you rose from a cave, you offer us the life that can rise as well. Help us to listen to you and trust you just a little bit more tonight. And right now, I'm just going to invite you to think about what area of your life are you not trusting him more than you could? Is it forgiveness? Is it generosity? Is it being positive? Is it just faith? Is it spending time in God's word? Is it loving people more than you could? Is it standing up for truth when everybody else is running after craziness? What is it? Take a moment and ask God to pull you out of that cave. Lord, we give those things to you and invite you. Move the needle of our hearts a little bit more towards you. And as we move forward in the coming weeks, looking more at your life, help our life to find itself more and more tethered to it. So that one day we too might rise from the cave. In your name, all God's people said, amen.
go. Feel free to go. We'll see you next week, but we got one more for you.
working.
Do you need avenging?